Please, for the Pledge of Allegiance.
For the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you all. Mrs. Meltzer, are there any additions or deletions to tonight's agenda?
Yes, there are two deletions. Item number two, update and complete of consumer energy Macomb Center Berm, and item four, request for approval of moratorium on IFT.
Mr. Keys?
Mr. Kenyon, if I could make a motion to adopt the agenda with the removal of item six.
I support.
There's two other items that are being removed too.
The other issue is we have to have this in place.
Well, I'm sorry, I think because I had to refresh the page, it's item number five. So I'll make a motion to adopt a amended agenda with the removal of item five.
These folks, a lot of them are here to speak to that item.
And I imagine under public participation, we would still honor that.
I support.
You support that?
Mm-hmm.
I will not support that.
No.
But they have a right to ask for a vote.
Mr. Cannon, we did not, I have not taken roll call. So I think that comes before the approval of the agenda.
It does. Roll call, please. And welcome to our new board member this evening.
Thank you.
Ms. Trustee Julie Matuzak.
I'm here.
Trustee Keys.
Here.
Trustee Patton.
Here.
Supervisor Cannon.
Here.
Trustee West.
Here.
Treasurer Gillingham.
Here.
Clerk Meltzer here.
Okay, now back to the agenda. The clerk has said that we're taking off item two and item four, and you're asking that we take off item five, the Columbus Day issue?
Yes, sir.
I'd like to vote on item two and four first because I don't have a problem with that, but I do have a problem removing item five, the Columbus Day issue.
Separation is always in order.
Yeah. So my request is for a roll call on the agenda, removing items two and four. And then, Mr. Keys, we will come back to your request to remove the Columbus Day issue.
So Maker and Support are in support of the separation?
Yeah. Yes.
Yes.
Roll call, please.
All right. So I'm sorry. You made the motion.
The motion is to remove items two.
Right, but
and
who
four.
Seconded that motion?
No,
I don't remember.
The motion was made by Mr. Key, supported by Ms. Patton, to approve the agenda with those three items removed. Mr. Cannon moved to have the items separated,
correct,
removing two and four.
And Ms. Meltzer, if I could just, as a motion maker, I'd like to vote
separately
on number five first and then vote on the two.
So we want to separate, you guys.
Everyone here, excuse me one second, Mrs. Meltzer. I know a lot of you are here because an item was put on the agenda 2 weeks ago that I didn't approve of, and it was put on in a way it should not have been put on. You will all have an opportunity to speak under public comment. If Mr. Keyes's item passes, you will not be able to speak to item five because it won't be in the agenda, but you will be able to speak on the Columbus Day issue, each of you, for 3 minutes at the end of the meeting. Now, the meeting's not gonna last very long because it's a very short agenda, so you would have that opportunity. I'm against that because I think the item has been placed on the agenda and we should speak to it. But I'm only one of seven who gets to vote. So now we're voting to not include items two and four on this agenda.
That's fair.
Mrs. Meltzer, approve the agenda. We will come back to Mr. Keyes's item.
Well, there's a motion though and a second, Mr. Cannon. So we do have to address that unless we want, this is a second. This will be a subsidiary motion. Yes, Mr. Doan, would you speak to that for parliamentary process? Can we go ahead?
Well, I think we all know what we want to do. We can, there's no discussion at this point. It's only to the board. Sir, you need to sit down, please.
I want to make a comment on the motion.
You may not. At this point, this is the board putting together the agenda. You will have an opportunity later in the meeting to speak.
So at this time, we're voting, we are making, the motion is to remove items 2 and 4.
Correct.
Okay. Who made that motion?
I did.
Well,
no?
I did, and Ms. Patton seconded the motion.
For 2, 4, and 5 to remove.
Well, we're separating the issue.
Mr. Cannon moved to have it separated.
Right. Yes.
So it's still there.
So Mr. Cannon.
And we're honoring that separation. There doesn't need to be.
I will, okay, and then I'll second that to Mr. Cannon so we can make a motion on that. So, all right.
This isn't that hard.
No, I know. Supervisor Cannon.
No, I'm not talking to you. Yes.
Clerk Meltzer, yes. Trustee Matuzak.
Yes.
Trustee Keys.
Yes.
Trustee Patton.
Yes.
Trustee West.
Yes.
Treasurer Gilliham.
Yes.
Motion passes.
Which he has a right to do. Mr. Keys made a motion to eliminate item 5, dealing with the Columbus Day issue, and it was supported by Mrs. Patton. Roll call, please.
Trustee Keys.
Yes.
Trustee Patton.
Yes.
Trustee Matuzak.
Yes.
Supervisor Cannon.
No.
Trustee West.
Yes.
Treasurer Gilliham.
Yes.
Clerk Meltzer, no. So it's motion. Really motion passes.
A cowardly thing to do.
To remove item 5.
Okay. Again, everyone here who wishes to speak to that item will have 3 minutes each at the end of this meeting.
I will have to go and make more cards, which I need. Yeah, can you do that for me? So you need to take one of those cards.
Okay, so now we have an agenda.
And Dan, so what do you want two on one?
You guys are killing me.
And then cut them. And then you need to take 100.
Anyway, welcome to your Township Board meeting this evening. We do have public comment at the end. For those who wish to speak to public comment, you do need to fill out a public comment card. I'm not sure, Captain, if you have enough cards, but each person needs to fill one out, and we will hear exactly what you have to say without debate at the end of this meeting. And thank you for coming to your Township Board meeting this evening. There are no other comments from board members, so we'll start with the consent agenda. Is there a motion to approve?
I'll make a motion.
I'll second it.
Roll call, please.
Trustee Patton?
Yes.
Trustee West?
Yes.
Trustee Matuzak?
Yes.
Trustee Keys?
Yes.
Supervisor Cannon?
Yes.
Treasurer Gilliham?
Yes.
Clerk Meltzer, yes. Motion passes.
Thank you. Item 2 has been deleted. Item 3. Resolution with the Clinton Township Inclusive Playground Area.
At a regularly scheduled meeting of the Board of Trustees of the Charter Township of Clinton, Macomb County, Michigan, held on the 28th day of November 2022, commencing at 6:30 p.m. Whereas outdoor recreation is crucial for physical and emotional well-being and social development. And whereas outdoor recreation helps build bridges between persons of different ages, abilities, and socioeconomic status. Whereas 15% of Clinton Township families have someone with a disability, 11% are below the poverty level, and 19% are seniors. Whereas an inclusive recreation area provides for greater interaction between persons of different backgrounds and abilities than an accessible playground by removing the barriers to inclusion and by providing a sensory-rich experience for all. Whereas inclusive recreation benefits parents and grandparents with disabilities and encourages cross-generational play that is beneficial to families. Whereas community safety is improved when we foster interaction that improves understanding and empathy between persons of different backgrounds and abilities, and whereas 9% of the state's special education students are in Macomb County, and 20% of Macomb County's special education community is served in Clinton Township. Whereas the Macomb Intermediate School District is located within 2 miles of Clinton Township Civic Center and serves those with disabilities throughout Macomb County. Whereas Clinton Township had previously established the Inclusive Playground Committee to support the development of inclusive play within Clinton Township, Whereas the Charter Township of Clinton has a proud history of supporting initiatives like the Challenger Field and Neil Reed Park and other inclusive initiatives. Now therefore be it resolved that the Clinton Township Board of Trustees hereby authorizes the application for a SPARK grant of $685,000 to allow for the building of the Clinton Township Inclusive Recreation Area on the Clinton Township Civic Center grounds.
If I may, sir, the reason you're seeing this tonight, you heard the you voted on the application last time, and we're just asking you to put that in the form of a formal resolution with a lot of our key arguments in it, because they're asking for that as part of the grant package. So we figure every time they read a letter from us, they wanted to see some of the arguments. So you'll see that in those. You'll see that in some of the support letters we've asked some of the organizations around here to do, and we're getting great support letters. But we wanted to start with this one from you guys saying you're in support of it. So that's why you're seeing it tonight, in addition to having seen it last time.
So moved to adopt the resolution.
Support.
Discussion? This is one of the very positive things on the agenda tonight. Roll call, please.
Yes, and it includes inclusivity. Yeah, you can pass those on. Thank you. Clerk Meltzer, yes. Trustee West?
Yes.
Trustee Matuzak?
Yes.
Trustee Keys?
Yes.
Trustee Patton?
Yes.
Supervisor Cannon?
Yes.
Treasurer Gilliham?
Yes.
Motion passes.
Item 4 has been removed from the agenda, and item 5 was just removed from the agenda. Item 6, request approval of board meeting and holiday schedule.
All right, Mr. Cannon, the board has received 3 calendars, A, B, and C, and I would like to make a motion to approve calendar A for the calendar year.
I'm fine with that. I will be unavailable on the 28th of August.
Mr. Cannon?
Yes.
If I could speak to the schedule, obviously with this entire packet, as a trustee, I just received the packet this morning. I don't know if I'm alone in that. No. So all board members have only received these calendars. Were these sent out any other way?
They were on the board packet.
Yeah, that was the only way.
So, but what I'm saying is the board packet was not available to any of the trustees until this morning.
I don't know why that was. I'm not sure why that would have been. Would have been Friday. Well, actually, I think it was.
It was late last night.
Yeah. Okay.
Late last night.
Yeah.
Right, so when I woke up this morning, I went to my email and I saw the entire board packet, mm-hmm. everything we have to vote on tonight, including this calendar, the 3 mm-hmm. calendars. So yeah, I would imagine we would want to move this to the next meeting so that way board members could actually read it.
Well, how hard it is to read. Did you read any of the board packet?
I prioritized the items in which we're going to need board approval tonight. Yeah.
Yeah.
Thank you.
And so I did not have time to consult my calendar and this calendar. Now, the schedule can always be changed. So if it's the wish of the board to revisit this, I guess I'm asking other board members. First, I was concerned if I was the only person who only got the packet last night or.
But you weren't. I didn't even see it. I tried to access it and I couldn't see it. So I'm really just saying it now. So I can't even speak to what. Which one works for me?
January.
Do you have to have this done tonight?
I'm not sure. I think I do.
Mr. Dolan, could you speak to the requirements of the Open Meetings Act? I believe it's by the first meeting of the new year.
Yes.
We have 2 more meetings in December.
Correct.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. All right, we'll put it. Oh, you know what? We do have the next week's meeting.
Right. We can do it on the 19th.
We can postpone it to the 19th.
I will entertain a motion to postpone. Some of the board members did not receive the information.
The 5th. Postpone to. I'm sorry. Look at the board calendar.
Postpone to the 5th.
So, I just even looking at that meeting, I think traditionally we cancel that meeting as this is another back-to-back meeting. Which we didn't cancel the first one. So, I would think that we would be canceling the 5th and that we would want to postpone this to the 19th.
We don't cancel the 5th.
We would cancel the 19th if we're going to do anything. I'm sorry, I didn't mean to tell you what to do.
Yeah, let's put.
Would we need a meeting back to back? Obviously, Mr. Cannon, you talked about this agenda being light.
We can postpone to December 5th. Do you have a motion? I'll make that motion.
Support.
I just want to make sure that it doesn't affect you in your clerk's office.
We do need both in December.
Okay. Sir?
Yes, Sam Bushel, 18546 Wayland Drive. I also would like to say that I had looked for the agenda and for the packet as late as 10:30 last night. It wasn't at 10:30, so I don't know what time it came on. But there are so many items on this whole packet that people, to speak to it, they can't find out. I literally had put it out on a website that's to our area saying, hey, I bet there's something really hot on today's meeting because we didn't get the agenda. Whenever it's not posted, and by law, it had to be posted by 1:30, so...
Yeah, it was posted in enough time. However, we are transitioning staff, and I apologize for that not being on earlier, but it is in compliance with the Open Meetings Act.
Okay.
Roll call, please.
Clerk Meltzer, yes. Trustee West.
Yes.
Trustee Matuzak.
Yes.
Trustee Keys.
Yes.
Trustee Patton.
Yes.
Supervisor Cannon.
Yes.
Treasurer Gilliham.
Yes.
Motion passes.
Item 7, site development plan approval for a parking lot extension for FedEx.
Mr. Cannon, this was read into the minutes of the last meeting and was asked to sent to the planning commission, the planning director, and is now before us again.
Good evening.
I think that you met with our planning director and you've come to a compromise, and our planning director is very happy. I'm happy with what he told me.
Have you seen the plan?
I'm sorry?
Have you seen the plan from Mr. Thompson?
Yes.
The fencing?
Okay. Yes.
That's what we're going to do on the fencing.
Perfect.
So, Mr. Cannon, if I can?
Yes.
So, when this was postponed last time, it was actually just postponed to this meeting, allowing time for the petitioners to look at the fencing, try to do some... upgrades that would then allow us to be in compliance with our gross spec corridor study.
Correct.
That is looking for updates. And it's my understanding that this is going to be now the wrought iron aluminum fences along the roadways. In other words, 15-mile road and on gross spec, but that it would still be chain link on the sides.
Correct.
Of the property.
Correct.
And that would allow the development to go forward for FedEx to do their expansion and to keep them here in Clinton Township, right?
We appreciate it, yes.
Okay, all right. And when I requested the planner's sort of opinion on the landscaping, you guys have over-landscaped it, so
yes.
We appreciate that.
Sure.
Okay. Yeah. I'll make a motion to approve.
I support.
Roll call, please.
Oh, wait.
Sir, you have a question about this item?
Yes, I do.
Okay.
Many. There again, this FedEx is actually a leased spot, so we don't know if it'll be FedEx forever. And the way this is set up on the plan that you have before you, it literally only lists the one lot, even though that particular lot has no building on it whatsoever. So this would only be for a new parking lot. It does have the planner's letter points out that there's truck storage there. It doesn't point out where that truck storage is. The wrought iron, the aluminum wrought iron fence would not meet the screening requirements for a truck storage lot. This is directly across from homes. I would say that they did add the sidewalks now on 15-mile road. The sidewalks are in place on the Grossbeck part of the property. Now, because the plan that you're approving tonight actually covers both lots, you can look at it. It goes beyond. That means that the other property also should be brought up to date, and the Grossbeck corridor plan would call for the sidewalks to be put in, because there are other sidewalks in that area on Grossbeck, and also some landscaping up there. There's no dumpsters called out on this plan anywhere, and this is hardly an improvement. I must say the landscaping that they've added since the last meeting is much better. There's quite a few things that were added, but there's still a whole bunch of deficiencies that I pointed out to all of you in a letter earlier today. So it's a matter of, this isn't a surprise. And you have known since the last meeting, I pointed out that the plan covers two lots, not the lot that you're voting on. The way it is, if this is a standalone thing, let's say FedEx leaves tomorrow, you now have a new separated truck lot that people can store right on 15 Mile Road with no building, no dumpsters, no bathrooms, nothing. This does not meet the Grossbeck Corridor Improvement Plan whatsoever. Thank you.
Thank you. You're incorrect, but we are glad. No, I'm not going to argue with you. You're incorrect.
You argued by saying I'm incorrect,
there
sir.
There is a sidewalk already on Grossbeck.
Oh, is there?
Oh, yes.
And it's not on the plan.
It's on the plan.
It's not on the plan.
Sir, you're incorrect in what you're saying. You're entitled to say it, no matter how incorrect you are. We have a motion and a support on the floor. Roll call, please.
Treasurer Gilliam.
Yes.
Trustee Patton.
Yes.
Trustee Matuzak.
Yes.
Trustee Keys.
Yes.
Supervisor Cannon.
Yes.
Trustee West.
Yes.
Clerk Meltzer, yes. Motion passes.
Thank you. Site development plan approval for proposed La Paloma at Partridge Creek.
This commission has made review of the site development plan for proposed La Paloma at Partridge Creek and finds the proposal is in compliance with the requirements of Clinton Township Planning and Zoning Code and those of other replying reviewing agents. We hereby make recommendation for approval of the proposed site development plan, and this action was passed by unanimous vote. This matter was petitioned by Dominic Mosheri, Partridge Creek Holding LLC. We submit this proposal for consideration and would appreciate advisement of your determination. Sincerely, Bruce Thompson, Director of the Clinton Township Planning Department.
Thank you. Mr. Mosheri is here if anyone has any questions. It looks like a very nice project. Mr. Mosheri and his organization have done everything they've told us from day one till today, and I'm sure they're going to continue with this beautiful project all the way through to the end.
We want you on 15 in Grossbeck, too.
Mr. Cannon, if I may? Okay, so 32 sites, correct?
Correct, 32 townhomes.
Okay, and then 80 parking spaces?
Yes, that's the correct number.
So people are going to have access to these apartments off of Dove Street.
That is correct.
As well as the strip mall parking lot.
That was part of the consent judgment and site plan, so yes, it continues.
Okay. And traffic in the area can be somewhat intense at times.
Yes, but if no pressures added by our community. The Dove Street and Park Street Boulevard is under consideration over the years with the Road Commission of Macomb County, and I'm sure those talks will continue. And if you see, we have on our site plan, we've preserved that entire open space and wood area. And if there needs to be an improvement in the future date, we'd be more than willing to accept a access or grant of property to accommodate that expansion if and when necessary and determined by the township and the Road Commission.
Okay. And this is a separate development than the Montclair and of the other, because those are sort of, you know, units that are more ranch style, I guess.
There's townhomes in there. Okay. This is a embodiment that completes the development in that area of the township, and adding this 32 townhome community will enjoy the amenities at Mount Clair at Partridge Creek. So it'll be part and parcel and managed by the same management team, leased out of the same offices, and they'll be able to use the same community facilities.
That's good. Okay. All right. So when you guys came forward on the Montclair and told me these were going to be apartments with rents ranging from, you know, $1,400 to $3,000, I was like, you've got to be kidding me. But I know you know your market research better than I do, but it's astounding to me that you have a waiting list for...
Yes,
you know,
we do. And in Mount Clair, Partridge Creek, there's a waiting list. And we are in development of two phases right now, simultaneous. And there is one phase remaining. And so this is a sister community as part of that. And I think it bundles it up nice that at least you don't have any unknowns what will be done there in the township in this area.
Okay. I appreciate you being here.
Yes. Okay. I'll make a motion for approval.
Support.
Their project is one of the best in Michigan and has received numerous awards, And I think you just received something else recently too, Mr. Mashiri.
Yeah, this has received many national awards, Mount Clair Partridge Creek.
Yeah.
And it leads the entire Apartment Association of Michigan's as far as the detail quality and the size and the amenities that are all wrapped in a bundle. My father made a promise to this Board of Trustees that it's going to be something beyond expectations, and we're going to fulfill that promise. Thank you.
You always have.
Thank you.
And you have. Thank you. Roll call, please.
Trustee West. Oh, I'm sorry. Trustee Patton.
Yes.
Trustee West.
Yes.
Trustee Matuszak.
Yes.
Trustee Keys.
Yes.
Supervisor Cannon.
Yes.
Treasurer Gilliam.
Yes.
Clerk Meltzer. Yes. Motion passes.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Item 9, presentation of river trails for our strategic plan.
Good evening, Board. My name is Brian Cave, Director of Parks and Recreation, for all the residents in attendance. We just have a brief presentation for tonight, and we're going to get started with developing a river trail system. I'm here along with Mary Bednar, Director of Public Services. She is a co-chair along with myself for our presentations for tonight. So it's just a summary of our body of work that we've been working on for the past year and a half or so.
Thanks.
Have you looked at those keys too? That's one other.
Just a mail pleasure.
All right, so we're just going to go over a couple of our goals for these projects that we've been working on and the overall river trail system. So number one goal, increase accessibility to the river trail system. Some of our achievements, we've received trust fund grant for the township through the Michigan Department of Natural Resources for a kayak launch at George Park at the Woodrow Woody site. And that's also going to include a green parking lot. So we won't have much water runoff into the river, protecting our asset. Next would be to receive the federal funds that we've been awarded for the Clinton River, $640,000, and that's going to construct universal kayak launch at Bud Park and also include some cleanup initiatives along the river. Next, we participated with SEMCOG and the county and Harrison Township and Mount Clemens to apply for a $25,000 grant. And that was awarded to us, and that project is nearing completion. And we're hoping to incorporate that in our Parks and Rec Master Plan. So that's a great project. Mm-hmm. They tried to apply for funds for that for 3 years in a row. And on our third attempt, we received the $25,000. So that was a big ask for all the municipalities involved. Next, we have goal number two. So we're looking to phase in some ease of use amenities along the river trail system using financial sustainability projects and practices.
Can't close.
Sorry.
Oh, we need to, Dana.
Okay. We need to leave the doors open.
Well, they're trying to hear.
So we've partnered with Clinton River Watershed Council. They've been a great partner to us for a lot of these projects and a good resource to have. So one of the initiatives with the Watershed Council is for the whole water trail, we'd like to have some interpretive signage and directional arrows and signage along the river. So if you get lost on the river, you have to portage out, you need to somehow gain help, you have signage, it'll identify where you're at. We've already put signage on the whole river. With the Watershed Council, our signs are pink with black numbers. The next would be adding storage rack and other amenities to Bud Park and George Park once completed.
So going back to the signage real quick, each community has a different color. So ours is pink with a number on it. So the idea is when you're in a kayak, you don't know which community you're in. You can't say, you don't know. A lot of times you go under a bridge, you don't know, are you going under Garfield Bridge or what? So the idea is if you needed a call, you could say, to 911, I just saw pink number 2. And then our fire department knows that you're past pink number 2, but you haven't seen pink number 3 yet. So it gives them where you are approximately. If they said green number 2, you're in a different community, and they would say, you better call whatever, and I don't know all the community colors, so I don't want to say that a community and be wrong, so, but it would be, that's a different community, so that community would need to respond.
So when you do get out on the river, it's beautiful, you feel like you're up north, but sometimes you might lose your sense of direction and your bearings and want to give direction for emergency services. Goal number three, improve water quality. So a couple achievements with that, especially related to removing SSOs in the Clinton River. $35 million worth of projects have been completed. We're the only township along the river that's completed all their SSOs, to my knowledge, and that's a great feather in our cap as a township. So,
yeah, we had celebrated that a couple months ago here with the, because we were under an amended consent order from the state for over 21 years, and a lot of work went to that, but knock on wood, we haven't seen the final paperwork yet, but we are waiting. It's been submitted to the state, and we're waiting to get that so that we can get out of the ACO.
So the SSO is the combined sewage, and we no longer have that. We redeveloped the township parking lots, and we're including green infrastructure techniques, and including the bioswales, also helpful and friendly to the nature.
So currently our first parking lot we did was Reed Park, and we actually did that one approximately 15 years ago. And then we went and did the Civic Center parking lot here. And if you'll notice, we actually never had islands out there, but when we put the islands in, instead of building the islands up, we built them down so that we can collect water and store water there and treat it before it gets into the main system. We've also done it at Normandy. We made Normandy parking lot a little bit smaller, but now it all drains into that rain garden / butterfly garden. And we are actually going for a grantor to do a similar thing at Joie Park.
We're also continuing to work with Clinton River Watershed Council, promoting and making the river more accessible and providing cleanup opportunities and just more volunteer and educational opportunities for the whole township and its residents. We also treated all the splash pad water runoff, so there was no negative impact on our river system. So we included that in our design of the splash pad, and that was a little bit more forward thinking. On our behalf.
That's also a requirement. So when you put that amount of water into the storm system, it's treated potable water. So that's great for the kids that are in the splash pad that's drinking the water, but it's not necessarily great in that quantity and that amount to all the little critters that live in the ditches. So we actually, what we do is we dechlorinate the water before we actually send it to the ditch. So that it's safe for the kids who are playing in it, but it's also safe for the critters when it leaves the site.
In a lot of communities, they call that gray water. So. Goal number four, just maintain and complete projects using sustainability models. So whatever we put in, we want to make sure that we have money to repair and replace. So we're implementing those strategies for all of our projects when we're going out for grants, when we're going out to bid for items. We're making sure that's in our capital outlay for our budgets.
That's it.
Thank you. Yep. I'll open it to the board and then to the community. Mrs. Meltzer.
Thank you, Mr. Cannon. First, I want to thank both Mary and Brian for the presentation and the work that you put into this. As you stated, you've been doing this for over a year and a half, and a lot of the work that has been put into it is because of the both of you, as well as others. And our department heads are incredibly talented and hardworking, and we really appreciate all the effort that you put into this. This is exciting news for Clinton Township. I mean, having the universal boat launches at two park locations is a wonderful benefit to not only our residents, but it draws in other people from other communities and helps support our businesses as well. So this is a great project that not only recognizes the importance of keeping our waters clean, but also helps our economy. So thank you for the work you do on this.
Sir?
Yeah. Nope.
Hi, Dan. How you doing?
Okay, we have one more board member than you.
Okay, just very briefly. So one of the things that wasn't mentioned here is the earmark from Congressman Levin's office. $675,000.
Actually, it was. It's on the very first slide. Mm-hmm. That is the, because now it's not an earmark. Now it's considered a grant through HUD. I'm just trying to get
to it.
Oh, am I in the wrong one now?
Yeah, you're in the next one.
Sorry, guys.
We'll be back. Part two.
I don't think I leave the mic for a while, so we're...
Okay, so it's point two. Yeah. Receive federal funds to clear Clinton River with Township Board.
Yes, $640,000. Okay.
I just think it's worth mentioning that this was a $675,000 grant that, you know, to underscore the important work and, you know, what Ms. Meltzer said, you know, this is incredibly important work when you have all three branches of the Clinton River converging within one community. You know, we have a special responsibility to protect it, which is why we spent $35 million in sewer upgrades over the 20 years. But at the same time, now the next phase of this is to make sure that people can access it, that have room to recreate on it, to have that opportunity and those amenities that are going to make that possible for families. And so it's...
just to get a feel, though, the whole project is almost $960,000, and the grant is for $640,000.
Right.
So the remainder will be part of the township budget actually next year, the match money.
Yep. And that comes from our general fund, which is not increasing. It is under considerable threat as we become sort of transitioning from being an outer ring suburb to an inner ring suburb. And so... you know, but these are the things that I think keep us an amenity-rich community that allow us to serve the residents that we have here, creating more opportunities for them. The other thing I want to mention, the spillway study, because I think this is a great example of local governments working together. SEMCOG offered the grant. The county went for the grant. We've had considerable impact. When you think of the spillway, what other area in a suburban community creates the opportunity to create this many recreational opportunities? Where do you have an undeveloped piece of property that size with that much acreage that is, in effect, publicly owned, even though it's owned by inter-county drain boards and things like that? We own property along it as well, but we're the lion's share of this property. So Harrison Township, obviously, to the east of us, Mount Clemens, but Clinton Township is the bulk of this, and so this is an untapped resource, and I appreciate the work that's going into making sure that we create more opportunities. So, well done.
Thank you.
We have a resident who wishes to speak.
Dana Duggar, 37852 Suburban. I also would like to thank Ms. Bednar and her team and the township for the work that we do on our river and on our spillway as a 40-year neighbor to the spillway. One thing I would like to mention is there was, I think, $25,000 spent on signage. Mm-hmm. That signage, a lot of it along the spillway, was very quickly destroyed. It was a very flimsy, about the quality of a yard sign, and a lot of that went away very quickly on the spillway, so the signage needs to be of a more durable type, and one of the major things that we as neighbors to the spillway are always working on is picking up trash from the users. I call them the SOS gang, the slobs of society that leave their trash behind. And any projects that we undertake and attract for usage, we need to include the funding for housekeeping. If we're going to have people come and use it, we need to include the funding for cleaning up after those who will not clean up after themselves. I thank you so much.
Thank you, Dana. Further comments of board members or community? Mrs. Meltzer, do we have a motion?
So make a motion to receive and file.
I support.
I have a question.
Yes,
for them.
Of course.
To that end, what Dane was talking about, do we have garbage cans out there along the site?
So we do have on the spillway, we do have some garbage cans. We also have some at the fishing pier. We don't have them like in, like at, they're basically at the roads at the crossing so that we can get to them easily to maintain them. But unfortunately, we do have people that just don't use garbage cans, period. And so.
And I appreciate that, but also if they're not accessible, they won't use them. So.
Well, and so we have them basically at the trailheads at every road crossing, as well as at like the fishing pier where most people gather.
Okay.
We have them available.
Thank you.
We have a motion and a support. Roll call, please.
Clerk Meltzer, yes. Trustee Patton?
Yes.
Trustee Matuzak?
Yes.
Trustee Keys?
Yes.
Supervisor Cannon?
Yes.
Trustee West?
Yes.
Treasurer Gilliland?
Yes.
Motion passes.
Thank you. Item 10. Mrs. Bednar, you stay right there. Bid award for the water bills and envelopes.
Dear Board of Trustees, the Department of Public Services Water and Sewer Division solicited for bids to supply water bills and envelopes for the coming year. Three bid proposals were received timely, one from American Graphics, our current supplier, one from Earl Press of Muskegon, and a third bid from Craybar GBF of Texas. The bids were opened in the clerk's office Thursday, November 17th, 2022 at 10 a.m. by Deputy Clerk Kimberly Irvine. We recommend that American Graphics be awarded the bid. Their total bid amount is $28,875 for approximately a one-year supply, which is $350,000 each of bills number 9 envelopes and number 10 window envelopes to meet U.S. postal requirements. This purchase is accounted for within the budget for this year. Respectfully, Mary Bednar, Director of Department of Public Services.
Thank you. Any comments or questions of board members?
I'll make a motion for approval.
Support.
Did you want a question? Okay.
Well, it's not so much a question as I'm really glad to see this bid went to a Clinton Township business. I think it's really important that we support local, and I'm also really happy that this was bid out. I've seen way too many contracts not bid out, so I appreciate this.
Well, we every year we bid this out, or every couple years we bid it out, depending on how it's bid. This year we did see an increase in the amount because of the inflation and so forth, but the lowest qualified bidder was American Graphics, and we're very pleased too because they've given us great product and we've been using it for a couple years.
Mr. Gilliland.
Okay, and then Ms. Bednar, just a quick word on the fact that we're supplying the envelopes with the water bill, even though we have more and more people paying online. So your office does the billing, my office does the collection. So we both hear this while we've got the public's attention speak to this issue because, you know, we hear a lot of
issues. When you receive your water bill by mail, you also have a water bill and you have an envelope so that you can return your water bill and your payment. And we have found that that makes everybody's life easier because now all you have to do is look for a stamp and insert it into the envelope and it goes to the right space. You don't have someone writing the wrong address. They don't send it to the clerk or to the civic center when it needs to go to our post office box. It just keeps things a lot simpler. However, there are people that receive a paper bill, but then they pay online and they say, why do you send me this paper envelope? Well, for us to get bulk mailing, everything has to weigh exactly the same. So if I take some and don't have the envelope and some that do have the envelope, it actually will cost me more money than just putting the envelope in. Now I do have some wonderful residents who actually bring me their 12 envelopes every year and say, can you reuse them? And we do. If they can go back in, we will reuse them. So if people would like to bring them to us, we will reuse them because I am about saving money, but that might be asking a little bit much to drive your 12 envelopes in. But if you're coming to the Civic Center and you happen to have them, feel free to bring them to us.
Okay, and then, so at the same time, when we send out the tax bills, which go out in the mail December 1st,
you don't have the envelopes.
We don't have envelopes in that, and the part of the reason why is because, one, they have to weigh all the same, and then, two, we have over half of our taxpayers that are paying via the through their escrow account as a part of their mortgage. So those people getting those envelopes would be a complete waste of money, even though we have people that let us know that they want an envelope to be able to send that payment in.
So if you don't want all the extra paper, you can get your bill electronically, and you won't get any envelopes, and you won't get anything in the mail. So this is my plug to say, go onto our website and go ahead and click the button, and it walks you through how to do it. But you can get your electronic, you can get your water bill electronically. You can pay it electronically. You can get electronically and still pay it. You know, but you know, if you want, if you really conserve and want to conserve those that paper, feel free. And we now have that capability. We're in, and that makes our life a little bit easier as well.
Mr. Keenan. Mr. Keyes.
Thank you. And just quickly, and if you don't have an answer tonight, that's fine, but maybe you have a quick one. In our budget sustainability workshops, we've really been talking about the need to collaborate between departments to make sure that, you know, we can take advantage of that purchasing price. When I look at the unit price and then the total specifically for the number 9 envelopes, because I imagine that's something that the other departments may use, have we thought about building into the contract where we'd be able to, you know, purchase additional at that same unit price for other departments? Are they so specialized that no, we don't do that? Wondering if there's any coordination between departments.
We probably don't have number 9 envelopes going out, at least in bulk by any other department.
So the number 9 envelopes that we're talking about actually have the post office box printed right on it.
Okay.
So it wouldn't, and then the number 10 is the window envelopes, which has the resident and then the address.
Mm-hmm.
So unfortunately, these are pretty specific.
Okay.
So no, we haven't coordinated like that.
Great. Well, thank you very much. I appreciate the input. Mm-hmm.
Further questions?
Now, I know some of the residents may not want you to do this because then they wouldn't get their water bills, but I really need the paper.
Mr. Cannon, there is a motion and a second.
Roll call, please.
Trustee Patton?
Yes.
Trustee Matuszak?
Yes.
Trustee Keyes?
Yes.
Supervisor Cannon?
Yes.
Trustee West?
Yes.
Treasurer Gilliam?
Yes.
Clerk Meltzer, yes. Motion passes.
Thank you. Item 11, presentation of non-motorized vehicle pathway for our strategic plan.
Before we get started with this presentation, I just want to take a moment, shameless plug for our department. Christmas Aglow is next Saturday, December 3rd, 6 p.m. We'd love to see everybody out there. Welcome in the holiday season. Celebrate Christmas Aglow in the township. So 6 p.m., we'd love to see you there. All right, so we're going to start with the second part of our presentation for this evening. It's enhance our motorized network. Once again, as mentioned earlier, we had a whole team of our working professionals in the township. A lot of resources and assets went into these presentations and our year and a half of progress for these both of these documents today. So, first goal is connecting existing non-motorized pathways. So we want to enhance our assets that we already have in place for the township. Some of the achievements include finishing construction of the pathway connecting the Civic Center to George, currently the Tomlinson Arboretum, the Civic Center Park, Canal Park, and Bud Park, and then also George Park. It's all connected, and that's through the TAP grant that was recently completed along Cass Avenue.
We do have actually some plans about where to go next, and we are trying to, Mr. Gilliam actually referenced the spillway path and the idea of connecting to George to the spillway. Now we'd have to partner with Mount Clemens, so that's where that partnership comes in, because most of that pathway is actually going through Mount Clemens, but there is portions of Clinton Township. But then we've also talked about having spurs go south off of these pathways down to Metro Parkway where the Bonnier Trail is, and then going south from there to our other parks like Normandy and Prince Drury and so forth. So the idea is to ultimately have all of our parks connected by way of sidewalk or bike path to each other. Oh, sorry.
As she had mentioned, we partnered with the county. Some of these items will come up later as we roll out the spillway master plan, and it's a lot more connectivity and connectivity for proposed pathways and existing. We've also identified some future routes in the township connecting parks, amenities, schools, and looking forward to putting some capital improvement funds for that.
And I obviously jumped the gun on that.
That's okay.
Okay.
Goal number two, just phase in easy use amenities along the non-motorized pathways, such as garbage cans, the park restaurants areas, benches, just adding some artwork. We have the Bonnier Pathway art piece, which will be a major installation. There's funding for that project to be completed, and then adding some bike racks to the splash pad. So we want to encourage healthy lifestyles, people riding their bikes to township amenities, getting outside, getting some fresh air.
And then we'll be also looking at adding bike racks to other parks and so forth.
Goal number three, just existing our non-motorized network. And we've identified some sidewalk gaps and disclosing those and being resourceful with our funds. So when we say being resourceful with our funds, using CDBG funds when available for those sidewalk gaps. If we have a sewer project going along, including in the sidewalk to be prepared alongside of that.
So one of the things that my new assistant superintendent of DPW, Scott Kleinfeld, has done is he said before we can focus on, you know, sidewalks outside of our properties, we need to focus on sidewalks inside of our properties. So what we have is we went through all of our parks and replaced slabs based on if they were trip hazards or if they were cracked too much. So anyone that has visited our parks recently will see new slabs of concrete that has been put in to address our, you know, our own backyard, for lack of better words. We also have a proposed walking path to go in at Prince Drury next year. It will be similar to what we have in the Arboretum, where, and actually Normandy, at Normandy, it's not going to be a paved surface. It'll be more of a gravel, but wheelchairs can go on it, bicycles can go on it, so it's completely accessible, but it's more of a natural material, similar to what they have like over in Rochester area, as well as up in the northern communities. Brian already mentioned the using block grants to repair and to construct the ADA ramps. And the last is we are applying for a grant right now through Ralph C. Wilson Foundation to be able to put in a sidewalk that goes from our fishing pier that's on Harper and the Spillway. It would actually have a safe crossing at Alpine with a crosswalk, and then a sidewalk would go up that east side to the bridge. We had had some conversations recently about the bridge and whether or not we could cross on it because of the way it was designed and so forth. So we'll be able to then bring people from the north side of the spillway to the south side of the spillway where there's already a pathway, so that connects it. And then that also includes developing a disc golf course at that the new property that we recently bought at, we call it the Triangle property, but we haven't named it yet, so that's something we'll be doing in the future.
Another thoroughfares are Wellington Crescent in that area, for those unfamiliar.
The other thing with that disc golf is you will be able to maybe use that for like snowshoeing or cross-country skiing in the winter, which again goes right in line with this non-motorized network. Non-motorized, I mean, you gotta think winter too. We do get winter in here. So the idea of being able to snowshoe or cross-country ski in that area would also be used.
It could be great for economic impact. And goal number four, once again, maintain the completed projects using sustainability models. When we're looking into all these grants, providing funds for maintenance, providing funds for repairs in the future, and just making sure that we're resourceful with the township budget and having capital outlay for everything that we foresee as a need.
One of the things we're trying to take advantage of is recently a lot of grants have come out to actually do maintenance. In the past, in the 21 years I've been here, you get a grant to do something and then it's up to you to maintain it. Well, recently there's been a lot of grants saying we'll help you maintain these projects. So example, we got a grant to put in the Bonnier Pathway and now it's in need of repair. And ironically, now there is a grant, so we're gonna be applying and trying to get earmark money or a grant for that so that we don't have to do that repair. It's like $1.6 million. And so we're hoping to get away with a 25% match.
That's good.
Which includes the bridge over Grossbeck, right?
Actually, no, that's a different, that will be done, but it's not a part of the grant.
Okay.
You'll see that in the budget next year, though.
Can you go back a minute to the bridge on Harper? This has been an ongoing issue with pedestrians and crossing that bridge. The county road department will say it's a bridge. Bridges don't include sidewalks. They begrudgingly created an area when they reconstructed the bridge to sort of make it walkable, but it is still not classified as a sidewalk. Are we talking about adding, like we did over the Clinton
Be northeast of that.
No, so this would be on the land part.
This would be on the land part.
Correct. So to be an official sidewalk, the standard is 5 feet wide. It's only 4 feet wide.
Okay.
To be an official bike path, the new standard, it used to be originally 8 feet, and now it's 10 feet. And they're actually now talking about making it 12 feet. But at this point, the current standard is 10 feet. So it would just be a pathway so that people don't walk on the dirt to get to that area, because it's still there. It's still safer than walking in the road. So for, you know, so technically it isn't a sidewalk, but it is a safer crossing than doing, you know, walking on the white line.
And it also provides a connection to the existing gravel parking lot.
Okay. It's been an ongoing issue that this bridge was built with no pedestrian walkway over Harper. It's just
but
been fighting
make,
this for a long time.
They did make the correction on the north end so that at least now it doesn't, you know, fall off the end.
Right, exactly. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Supervisor.
So if I could, though, to that point, so here's the irony here, okay? So they put the ramps on one side of that bridge.
Right.
For pedestrian. They didn't put it on the other side, as Mr. Duggar will certainly point out.
Exactly.
But the real irony here is how many people have been to Jimmy John's Field and had to park over on the east down by Utica City and then have to walk along the same width of a bridge that is technically not a walkway. Yeah. And then
correct.
In order to get to the park. So, you know, like what they define and what they don't define is based upon what they want to pay for and what they don't want to pay for.
Amen. Amen.
That's the end of our presentation.
Okay. The board has weighed in. Anyone else on the board?
I can make a motion to receive and file if you like, Mr. Cannon.
Support.
Supported by Mrs. West. We have a resident who wishes to speak. We have two residents who wish to speak. Yep.
Hello. You know, the southwest part of the township where I live, the houses behind me are not Narset, they're in Fraser. The walkways on 15 Mile Road from Garfield to Utica Road, they're non-existent. And there are senior citizen buildings along there. People try to walk. We also have no sidewalks on Utica Road, no sidewalks on Garfield from 15 Mile Road to Utica Road. Kelly Road, our sidewalks end at the Disney Elementary School. So we can't get to any of the facilities, the bike path or anything else, safely. We have no parks there. If you look at the township map, you'll realize we have no parks. We have an awful lot of houses. We have an awful lot of new townhouses and homes being built. We're paying a lot of taxes. I think we really, really need to have them sidewalks completed for the safety. If you sit in my house, you'll see that there are people, including myself, walking every day. But you get to a certain spot and you cannot get any farther without going in the road. You see kids in the road all the time. It's dangerous. And so, you know, we're paying for all these other amenities. We can't get to them. And I'd hope that would come into this plan, because I looked at the whole plan. Nothing is mentioned about any walkways down in our area. So I guess, you know, we have to look at why, because there's no sidewalks on Grossbeck to complete. And it's all been in the plan. It's been the law for many, many years, and hopefully you can do something about it.
Thank you. Yes, sir.
Good evening again, Board. Dana Duggar again, 37852 Suburban. Thank you again. They mentioned partnering with the county on this. We're really, spillway issues, you're really partnering with the Clinton River Spillway Board, which is made up of the four counties and a representative of the State Department of Agriculture. what I've encountered with this board in the past is the representatives from the out counties, from Lapeer, Oakland, and St. Clair, they are not very concerned about what happens in Macomb County. Yes, their water shed flows through us, but it is not of their main concern. And getting a good response from them sometimes is very difficult. Trustee Matuszak mentioned the Harper Bridge. I have battled that for long, and they want to go on the technicality that that is not a walkway. That has been used as a walkway since the spillway was dug in 1949. And I'm currently, as you all know from sharing emails, I'm currently battling with the Macomb County Department of Roads and the County Executive's Office because they are quite happy to plow the snow from the roadway onto the walkway and then cause pedestrians to walk in the traffic lanes of a 45-mile-an-hour highway. The county does this while they find the funds to clear the Macomb Orchard Trail in northern Macomb County. That is unacceptable. When we talk about the sidewalks that we're repairing and feeding, this board will also take note that over the last couple of years, I have been petitioning you to get maintenance and repair of the sidewalks that, which will feed this bike path along Harper from 16 Mile to Wellington Crescent. Those are in need of updating and repair, a lot of uneven slabs, and that repair needs to happen. For the disc golf, I think that is an innovative idea that Mr. Gilham had brought to me last summer and showed that. We do need to address how is it accessed, where is the parking, and how is it cleaned up after. And the completion of these bike paths, the maintenance of the bike path, that's the other issue I was going to bring forth. I petitioned the Spillway Board to possibly use some of the $378,000 they got from the 6.38 acres that we purchased to repair the bike path that is within the property that they are tasked with stewardship of. It's not a whole lot between Shadyside Park and Union Lake Road. There's a lot of lateral fissures that not a lot of money, not a lot of fix, but the Spillway Board got a lot of money from, got $78,000 from our township and the balance from the state trust fund. And let's see if we can get them to spend a little bit of their budget on repairing the bike path on their property. So I appreciate what this board does, and I appreciate what our departments do in, as again, being a 40-year neighbor to this asset and keeping it up and keeping it in good order and being used properly is, as always, my goal is to keep the east-central portion of our township the most desirable portion for residents and their families. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. I concur. You've done a very good job with that, Dana. Mm-hmm. Mrs. Meltzer?
Would we have a motion in a second? Just letting you know.
Roll call, please.
Trustee Keys?
Yes.
Trustee West?
Yes.
Trustee Matuszak?
Yes.
Trustee Patton?
Yes.
Supervisor Cannon?
Yes.
Treasurer Gilham?
Yes.
Clerk Meltzer? Yes. Motion passes.
Thank you. We have one more item before
Thank
public comment.
Time.
If anyone
Thank
has
you.
Not filled out a card.
Mr. Cannon, we have, actually, I'm going to ask the board if we can add one more item onto the agenda that is necessary. It's one item, but two, I did consult with our attorney, and he said we can make it one motion. But if you
go ahead, read it.
So this would be an additional item number 13, which would be to adopt resolution 2A, which is for the special assessment district P-2034 South Miles paving schedule, and schedule that public hearing number one. And then the other adoption would be to adopt resolution 2A special assessment project P-2035 North Miles paving that, and schedule that public hearing for the December 19th Board of Trustees meeting.
Okay, well, that's a separate item, so that's 13, so we'll take that one first. then we'll go back to the overtime.
Okay. So this is something that we, so this is considered a 2A. Normally, our resolutions are 1 through 5. This one is 2A because the publishing was not done prior to the 10 days. So this is why it'll go back on the agenda. It has to be noticed per the law that we give it 10 days notice, written notice. So that's why it'll be placed on the December 19th agenda. And I need board approval.
Is there a motion to approve?
So moved.
Support.
Supported by Mrs. West. Roll call,
Mr.
please.
Mr. Cannon, is this a motion to add that to the agenda or to approve it?
To approve it.
Okay. I know that it was discussed just, you know, less than an hour ago that we'd be canceling the 19th. So hopefully we'll be coming together and figuring that out.
So, Mr. Cannon, we need to add it first. So the first motion is to add, and then the second motion will be to adopt.
I'll make a motion to add.
Is there a second?
Did you want to second it?
Oh.
Supported by Mrs. West?
Oh, you did? I thought he did.
Okay, this is to add item 13.
Trustee Patton?
Yes.
Trustee West?
Yes.
Trustee Matuszak?
Yes.
Trustee Keys?
Yes.
Supervisor Cannon?
Yes.
Treasurer Gilham?
Yes.
Clerk Meltzer, yes. Motion passes.
And we have a motion on the floor, correct?
Mm-hmm. We do, and I thought it was Mr. Gilham, but you're saying that it was also Patton and West that supported it, or Gilham?
I think Mr. Dolan is saying it has to be two separate, so
no.
They made the motion to add it to the agenda.
We did.
Yes.
So we did. Now it's on the agenda.
Yes.
And so now we need a motion
to accept.
To approve.
I did that.
No, you
motion by Mrs. Patton, supported by Mrs. West.
They took your motion as adding it to the agenda.
Well, I'll make that motion to accept.
That's approved.
Who wants to second it? Do you want to second it? Mr. Gilham seconds it.
Roll call.
Trustee Patton.
Yes.
Treasurer Gilham.
Yes.
Trustee Matuszak.
Yes.
Trustee Keys.
Yes.
Supervisor Cannon.
Yes.
Trustee West.
Yes.
Clerk Meltzer, yes. Motion passes.
So that's the schedule of the public hearings on the December 19th meeting.
Correct.
Okay.
The last item on the agenda before public comment is DPW overtime.
Dear members of the board, and this was read into the minutes in the previous board meeting. I'm not sure exactly. It was, seems very clear what DPW overtime budget is requesting. Is it necessary for me to read this again into the minutes? Has anything changed regarding information that we as a board need in order to approve this? I mean, it was postponed to and moved here for what purpose, I guess, is what I need to know why.
Mr. Cannon, I guess I could speak to that as I asked for it. I had asked for this to be moved over, and I'll first of all want to thank the accounting department and Director Bednar for working with me to better understand the issue. But as of now, I'm not comfortable with how we as a township currently prioritize these costs. In reviewing the overtime reports and invoices, I found that events at George Park, one park that makes up just one park in our community, accounted for almost $10,000 in overtime. The Gratiot Cruise, an outside organization, so not even a township department, accounted for $10,000 in township overtime, in which we only invoiced them for $6,000. So $4,000 we just, out of the general fund, took. I found that it wasn't a fair, I don't find that this to be a fair system, especially because at just a meeting ago, this board debated an $800 budget amendment to the same line item for over an hour when it came to Prince Drury Park. And so when it came to just getting a blanket request for $45,000 to increase that same line item, I don't believe that the cost that we anticipate in working with Director Bednar in terms of the snow plowing for fire, police, and heritage, I believe that we need to be looking at alternative funding sources. All of the three departments that I just mentioned have separate funds for that purpose. And we've talked about as a board how we can be more transparent and allocate those costs. And I think it's time that we do that. So I'll be voting no on the motion.
That's your privilege.
Thank you.
We have a motion on the floor?
No.
Mr. Cannon. As a brand new person who has not gone through the budget process before and is anticipating going through the budget process coming up, I'm very confused by this.
I can
So we're asking for a $45,000 increase. I understand the rationale here. We're short people. We're making people work longer, harder. I don't understand the time frame of this $45,000 in terms of our budget. I don't understand. Is this an ongoing cost we're anticipating for the next budget? Why wasn't this budgeted in? This is not a, being short of employees is not new.
It is, by the way, we are short employees.
Well, no, I totally get that, but that's not a new thing. So why aren't we budgeting for that? This is not a criticism. I'm just really trying to understand
this.
The process.
So we are in our budget planning process right now. And as much as I like to believe I know what's going to happen this time next year, I don't. But I have to guess. I have to make an engineered estimate. I have to figure it out. So when we did the budget last year, I did not know that I would not have a park ranger from June until 2 weeks ago. So I didn't budget that instead of having a park ranger close the parks, I would have to have a full-time employee who gets time and a half to do that. So those are the things you just don't know. It's a budget. It's not a guess. It's an educated decision on what you think. So based on what we've done in the past couple years, I said this is how much I need for overtime. The other thing is looking back, the last 2 years was, I hate to say it, COVID. And so we didn't have as much going on. For example, at George Park, we had homecomings this year. Last year, we didn't have homecomings. So we have to staff that park when we have that many people come to a park. We have to have extra staff there because it goes crazy. The Moravian goes crazy. The parking lot goes crazy. So that is why I'm here now. So when we determined that so I looked at the budget. And again, I'm asking for $45,000. It's a guess based on how much it snowed last year and the year before. And I looked at several years and said, about this time in December to March 31st, that's about how much overtime I use with snow removal and things like the Christmas Aglow. We have staff that go to that. We have, you know, the different events. So that's, again, a guess. I hope I guessed high so I don't have to come back and say, hey, I need another 10 grand to get through March type idea. But
so is this 45 an amending the current budget?
The current budget.
Okay.
And then next year, we'll do this whole process again. Fire's done this in the past where they've had to come back because they were short people and so they had more overtime. It's just, you know, it seems like the overtime is the one that's the hardest to determine. Because the other thing is you have, you know, an employee who might only make, you know, time and a half and they're just new at the employee, they get a lower rate than someone that's been here 20 years. So who ends up working it, you know, so it's a game that you look to try to figure out how it works. But based on what I know and what we typically spend on snow removal, $45,000 should cover me through April 1st. Knock on wood.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chair. I call you chair.
Mm-hmm. Further comments? We need a motion.
Mm-hmm. Chair, anything else to say?
I'll make a motion to approve the request for the DPW overtime budget.
I'll support.
Many things would be cut out that would be very important to the community as far as safety and use of our facilities if we did not do this. Roll call, please.
Clerk Meltzer, yes. Trustee Patton?
Yes.
Trustee Matuszak?
Yes.
Trustee Keyes?
No.
Supervisor Cannon?
Yes.
Trustee West?
Yes.
Treasurer Gillingham?
Yes.
Motion passes.
Thank you. Time for public comment.
Okay, let me clear out.
Quick.
I need any more cards?
Do they call up by the cards?
Okay. Here we go.
Mm-hmm. This is not a touch screen. It's touching it.
Thank you.
I know.
Let me briefly go through the board rules, if you will. Each person who wishes to speak will have 3 minutes to speak. Everything is addressed to me. Board members are not allowed to get into discussion with any member of the community. If there's any discussion and I can answer a question quickly or solve a problem quickly, I do it. But everything has to be addressed to me. If you're mad about something, be mad at me. Don't be mad at anybody else. I will convey that myself. Now, I know that there's a lot of people here who are probably interested in the Italian culture, and that's why you came out tonight. I think it was wrong for this board to postpone that item. I think it was cowardly, as a matter of fact. So you will have your opportunity to speak. That's what I'm trying to avoid that. You do have your opportunity to speak. I want to hear you. I'm not so sure everybody else up here wants to hear you.
Hello, Township Board members. My name is Joe Biondo. I'm a Macomb County resident, but I'm involved in the Italian American Cultural Center, which is down the street from here. And so I originally had thought that we would have an opportunity to present on why we think Columbus Day should be restored. A week and a half ago, most of the people in this room, in fact, I believe all of them, woke up to a very offensive headline in the Macomb Daily, quote, Clinton Township replacing Columbus Day with Indigenous Peoples Day. Now, the subtitle was interesting too. Martin Luther King Jr. Day, Juneteenth added as paid holidays. Where I work, we've been celebrating MLK Day as a paid employee holiday for quite a long time. Juneteenth Day was added early on in this year, so I applaud this board doing that. But I'm aware also of, quite frankly, the fact that it seems like Columbus Day being knocked out by the same resolution that you were using to approve MLK Day and Juneteenth seemed calculated to prevent us from coming out and just sharing our thoughts and being able to say, this is what we believe, and we want you to take that into account when you make a decision to knock out Columbus Day, replace it with another holiday, and call it inclusive. It's not being inclusive. It's being exclusive. You're being transactional. You're substituting out one holiday for another. And no one can explain to me what is the justification for having it on the same day as Columbus Day. Now, back in 2003, the UN passed a resolution recognizing August 9th as the International Day of World's Indigenous People. And so the question is, in our opinion, is that when a government makes an act, it should be justified. There should be a justification for it. What is the justification given for this? That it was inclusive? It was not. It does not meet the definition of the word inclusive. It simply does not. And so, with no justification given, I know my friend and mentor, Larry Rocca, sent this board on the same day this article came out, on November 18th, a three-page letter explaining why Columbus Day is important and should be celebrated, and a proposed resolution undoing what happened 2 weeks ago with respect to Columbus Day. And so he emailed that to all of you individually. And, you know, we're here a week and a half later. We got the room full of people that want to share things with this board that they didn't have the opportunity to do 2 weeks ago. And so we're all here. We can have that conversation. You've been on notice a week and a half with basically the general gist of what we want to talk about. And we were prevented from doing that. So instead of having six or seven people give an organized presentation and do a deep dive on things that you guys didn't appear to look into, things like, where did the first city, what was the first city that did this? Who were they? It was Berkeley, California. If you know anything about the politics of Berkeley, it's quite interesting. And you can actually look up the history of the people that put it together. And if you go through the history, they put together a citizen commission that was part of the city of Berkeley. This commission had a racial quota. 50% had to be of Native American descent. And the non-natives had no input on any decision that would impact the Native Americans. And so what I'm saying is there's a lot to talk about here, and we haven't had an opportunity to give our input. That's unfair to us, especially in light of all the Americans of Italian descent that are in this township that celebrate Columbus Day as more than just a celebration of Italian heritage, but really a celebration of Western civilization. The whole idea in our Declaration of Independence is the fact that we get our rights from God. That would have never happened without Columbus Day and the story behind that.
Thank you.
Supervisor and members, I'm Larry Rocca, 38299 Moravian, Clinton Township resident. When you were making the decision to substitute Columbus Day by removing, by substitute Indigenous Day, by removing Columbus, Christopher Columbus Day, are you aware that Christopher Columbus Day is a federal national holiday implemented by law in 1934 by the 34th Congress, signed into law by Franklin Delano Roosevelt. That was back in 1934. So this is a national holiday, and it's in existence, and October 12th is that date. What I'd like to clarify with you is that did you take into consideration your constituents, your citizens, and your voters of Clinton Township of American of Italian descent who celebrate Christopher Columbus Day every year? Something to consider regarding Italian Americans in Clinton Township, and I'm sure that you may have thought of this. The Italian Cultural Center on Romeo Plank, the Italian Tribune paper, which is distributed all over Clinton Township as well as Macomb County, Luciano's Italian Restaurant, I know you've all been there, Freddy's on Garfield, Lucido Insurance Agency on Garfield, Randazzo Fruit Market, Salvaggio's Fruit Market, Vince and Joe's Fruit Market. These are all Italian-American businesses that are in Clinton Township, and they do a lot for Clinton Township, and they love Clinton Township as I do. So that's why we're here. We're here to try to help you make a proper decision regarding Christopher Columbus Day. We want you to restore it back to its proper name. And you can also do Indigenous Day. There are 365 days in the year, and any one of them could be appropriate for that day, and we would support that. But we would like Columbus Day restored to Clinton Township for October 12th, which is the national holiday that Franklin Delano Roosevelt signed into law in 1934. I thank you very much.
Mr. Sorrentino?
I guess everybody knows where I come from, right? I've been over here a few years, about 52 years. Anyway, I've done a lot of construction. I built a lot of buildings, properties in this town. And I would like this board to reconsider what was done a few weeks ago. I feel that there's a lot of people, a lot of different people, too, that sometimes being discriminated. Today, I feel like I'm being discriminated. And I support anybody that gets discriminated in our country. So I don't think there's too much that I can say other than what everybody else said. But please, when you go home tonight, make sure that you think about this thing. And let's make it right. I mean, it's not hurting anybody. I like to know, sometimes I have a question. What makes this board decide to take something down without the people knowing about it? You know, like we would like to know, like if this was, whenever was somebody thought about it, to let the people know about it so we can talk about it before people make motions and approve and not approve. That's what I would like to know. I think we have more important things to do in this town than just take a holiday out, put another one. We can put all the holidays we want. By the way, why do we want to take Columbus out? All of us have a problem with it. So, please, when you go home tonight, think about it. Let's reconsider this thing, and we'll get along, and we keep on working for this beautiful town. Thank you.
Thank you. Enzo? Oh, I'm sorry, Mr.
You mind, Bob? Thank you. Thank you, Board, for having us speak. Tony Forlini. I'm not a resident, but my parents are residents. I should say my dad is a resident. My mom is also at Resurrection. But you guys have the toughest job in all of politics, local boards and the things that you do. I was a township supervisor. I understand the difficulties and the decisions you need to make. And I know all of you personally. I know Trustee Matuzak and Mike Keyes, you're over at the county, and Tammy and I, we go to many events together. Paul, you know, I know you've helped my dad out with various issues, and those are important things locally. And Kim, of course, being a township clerk, and Bob, we were trustees together. And Joie West, you and I went door to door together because of a local issue, because of something where the residents
behind Chippewa Valley couldn't park their car in front of their house because the kids at the high school were parking and taking up all the streets. That's the issues that really face local boards. Those are the things that all of you need to be worried about, need to be concerned about. The business owners that are here, the taxpayers that are here, boy, there's a lot of issues that you guys have to deal with. Columbus Day doesn't need to be one of those. I congratulate you for adding the holiday. I can't believe that it's taken this long for Martin Luther King holiday to be recognized. That's a national holiday, and Juneteenth. Congratulate you on that. But taking away Columbus Day is a slap in the face to a lot of the Italian Americans, of which, I got to tell you something, I live in Harrison. There's not a lot of Italians there, but there is a lot of Italians in Clinton Township. I think you need to recognize that they're offended at what was done. And take a look at it. I don't think that was a necessary motion. I don't think it was necessary. I don't think it was something that you needed to have on your backs. So, you know, I speak on behalf of a lot of people here and a lot of people in the community. You know, I sponsor the Columbus Day celebration in Lansing. Before me, it was Steve Bita. It was a bipartisan thing. It was something very much loved by the people in Lansing and loved by the people here. Reconsider it, because this is really a very passionate thing for the people in this room and the people in your community. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Hi, good evening. My name is Mark Papali. I am a Clinton Township resident. I'm a Clinton Township voter. I also have the privilege of serving as president of the Columbus Day Celebration Committee. And I am insulted by the fact that you did, that my board did, as Clinton Township resident. I just want to give you a little bit of history about Columbus Day and how it came to be. Back in New Orleans in 1891 was the largest mass lynching in the United States. 11 Italian Americans were killed and hung in New Orleans. The media applaud this lynching. You won't find this in any book. And just recently, the United States government apologized for this act. And this is what preceded the mindset of Columbus Day. In 1892, President Harrison urged Americans to celebrate Columbus. And this started a trend, mainly in Italian American communities, to start admiring and celebrating and developing and building statues and holding parades like we have done here in Detroit and in Clinton Township and in Mount Clemens. It's given people a sense of dignity and pride, something for us that we really enjoy. And it's been going on for decades. Italian Americans have endured insult, ridicule, and stereotyping. One of the most common stereotypes is how are you in the mob? And you think, well, maybe that doesn't happen nowadays. But let me tell you something. Last week, in the course of my business, I was explaining to somebody how to pronounce my last name. And I said, well, it's Italian. He goes, oh, are you in the mob? Yeah, this happens. So it does happen in 2022. It's as if the Italian Americans are the last group of people that people are comfortable stereotyping. And I just don't understand it. And this act is kind of along those of discriminating against Italian Americans. Where's the political correctness in this case? Where's the wokeness? Why aren't we part of that wokeness? I don't get it. I don't understand it. And maybe one of you guys will enlighten me. Columbus has been subject of revisionist history for years now. Mainly, I think, since the early 90s. And we in the Italian American community have celebrated Columbus Day for decades. We not only celebrate the man, but we celebrate symbolically the fact that he came over to this country, and we see great-grandparents, grandparents, many of the people sitting in this room who came over to this country. That's how we view this. So I'm urging you to reconsider, to retract this. And like it was stated before, I don't really have a big problem with some of these other holidays going on at the same time, but I don't understand what's the benefit of extracting this and getting rid of Columbus Day. I just don't get it.
So I'm asking that you reconsider that and that you rescind this. Thank you.
Thank you. Actually, I have a list of, in I'll order here. Then I'll just call your name.
Go ahead, Enzo.
I have Mark DeSpoke. Mr. Lucido?
I'm going to have him go first.
Okay. And you, sir, your name?
Enzo, E-N-Z-O. Think of Lamborghini when you think of that, or Ferrari.
I got it.
You'll always remember my name.
I got
okay.
it.
Okay. Not that I have one, but sometimes it's nice to have to look for a good car. My presentation is really not going to be about the statistics and things that went on in the past, except for one thing. That was me. I'm an Italian-born American. I was born in Italy, came over here, and when I came over here, I remember my mother waking us up with my two brothers as we passed the Statue of Liberty. And I've always remembered that sight as I passed by there, or read about American history, and what it represented, the freedom that we represented. Then later on, I felt that I was not being true to myself and looking around at what's going on in the United States. And I found Christopher Columbus. Christopher Columbus was a person that was genuine, who was from Italy. And he started doing all his exploring. I read the exploits of his journeys throughout the southern part of the country. And suddenly I had a second person that I could look up to, someone who was bold, brave, discovering new worlds, and also working with Queen Isabella of Spain, he founded a new world because she was the one that granted his passage. But one of the things that she demanded was to find souls. She was a very devout Catholic and told Christopher, give me as many souls as you can because I want some of these indulgences that the man upstairs wants. When he did that, he went to the, of course, they found the area where he was going to go was like southern Florida or Cuba or that area there. And when he landed, he found a general population over there, and they became quickly friends very quickly. How do I know this? There's a lot of speculation on things like that. But he was required to keep a captain's journal, as most captains are, and to say what happened every day. And this, what he did was he ended up to find people that had to be baptized. Being baptized in that world, in that time, was by the decree of Queen of Isabella. But here's the interesting thing, where people think that he was initiating slavery or he had slaves. He didn't, because what he did was he baptized as many indigenous people as he could. Once you're baptized during that time, in that period, you cannot become a slave. So if he baptized 15 people in a day, 15 people could not become enslaved. So that part of it I'd like to make clear. There wasn't, I think there's a lot of things saying that he came over here to slaughter people and rob them. And actually, he's a very gentle man when it came to dealing with the indigenous peoples. Just like to add, too, that I have two heroes. I have Statue of Liberty, Christopher Columbus. Now I've discovered a new one, which is Abbott Costello. Okay, Abbott Costello was a great comic. Also, if you read up about him, he's also a great patriot and entertained the troops anywhere in the world during World War II. And he did it for nothing and made him laugh and brought him back safely. So,
thank you, Renzo.
With my third hero, thank you very much, and I hope that you look at the human side of it rather than the perceived atrocities and bring back and repeal the legislation you just passed. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Lucero.
Good evening, members of the board. I have been practicing law a long time on Garfield Road and know every one of you and I respect you all. And there is a thing to say about fundamental due process. Fundamental due process. It's what every one of you took an oath. Every one of you swore that you would go ahead and support a constitution. You would allow the people to speak. You would allow the opportunity for them to be heard, because that's what our hallmark of our system's all about. What I saw today was a room full of people that are very passionate, loving, caring, kind. These are individuals that grew up in Italian families, that were proud of their Italian heritage, that cared about those heritages that were brought over on a boat long ago. I wasn't around in 1400s, neither were these individuals. My grandma and grandpa come here from a different country to give a better chance for all of us. We make the best of it. But I do know, living in Clinton Township, I felt a very harsh reality, which was there was good camaraderie. There was karma that was genuine and concerning. And when they get together, they can do good things, great things. They built a community here in Clinton Township, the Italian Americans. We feel very depressed about what actions were taken, but it's not because it was done behind closed doors and it was put on an agenda, but it wasn't given an opportunity to be heard. And every one of us talked about fundamental fairness, the righteousness that we all should have, the ability to speak. You took an oath in office to listen to the individuals that pay the bills, your salaries, that pay for this community by the tax dollars the Lucido family have given over the years, the Sorrentino families by the buildings and the tenants, by the kindness that Vincent Joe's and all the rest of the fruit markets have done, by giving charitable. What upsets me the most is because we weren't given an opportunity tonight. We brought here in groves for one reason. We want to tell you a different story. Not because we can change your minds, but because we want to know why the tax dollars are spent to change holidays instead of doing the right thing for the people. Why I'm sitting here in this building saying, why did they even take action on this? Is this something the taxpayers that vote for them to put them in office wanted? Or was this something that they wanted to have their own agenda to do? I mean, respectfully, take a look and listen to the individuals that are here. I don't want to go through and repeat everything. Your time is valuable, but my pride and heritage, I'll die for. I feel like I was stepped on because an Italian American couldn't buy a house in Grosse Pointe years ago. They didn't want the Italians in Grosse Pointe. No particular reason. But there was never fundamental due process. And when I went to law school, like some of the other lawyers that are here tonight, we believe in the right to be heard, an opportunity to present our case. I can't bring Christopher Columbus back and you can ask him questions. But to get rid of a holiday that we even celebrated as Italian Americans and also were honored by the Columbus Day parades that were put on down here in Mount Clemens and put on down on Woodward Avenue when I was a child, it disturbs me because I want to feel like I gave something to my children and you take it away, like my grandma and grandpa gave to me. This is the spirit of the holidays. Please remember, don't take away a gift that we were given, our pride and our joy of being Italian Americans. Give us the same opportunity to live our lives with the same respect that you want to live yours.
Thank you, Mr. Lucido.
You may or may not remember, we've had a number of parades here in Clinton Township also. In fact, right on these grounds. Don't forget Clinton Township there.
I remember.
Yes, I remember. We had some very nice ones.
Good evening, members. My name's Anthony Urbani II. I'm an attorney. I'm representing Mr. Garofalo, who lives on 16655 Millar, who was unable to speak tonight and asked me to speak on his behalf and on the other people's behalf here. I, too, am an Italian. I first generation here. My mother and father were both born in Italy. When I was in graduate school in philosophy, I remember a book entitled Come, Let Us Play Gods. And I'm wondering if that's what society is, and that's what we are going too far doing today, and that is an attempt to decide, to judge, and to evaluate certain people. We've done it, and we've seen it across the United States with doing that. seems today that we have been focusing on the hurt, and that'll continue the suffering. We should focus on the lesson, and that'll give the healing. So what did we do? You have made a decision, and if Einstein told us anything, he told us that the theory of relativity is nothing more than we all have different frames of reference. And we know your frame of reference. And for whatever the reason was, you heard tonight all these other people's frames of reference. And it's a different frame, a different reference for the same reality. The reality is that these people have pride. When the Pledge of Allegiance was said tonight, no one was on one knee. They all stood up. This is the country that they want to believe in. This is the country that they are fond of. They're an American. They're an Italian-American. And so we're asking you, much like the football games today, the sports games today, you know, in the old days, they called, made a call, and they didn't know whether it was right or wrong. Well, with the modern technology, you get a replay. We're asking you for that replay. And when you make that replay, you'll find out it was a bad call. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Board. My name is Joe Aragona. For those of you who don't know me, I'm actually the next state representative from the northern part of our township. I'm here today because I also am an Italian-American. I'm very proud of my heritage, of the hard work that my great-grandparents, grandparents, and parents put into this society. I served a term on this board, and I remember Trustee Keys wanted to change Columbus Day to Indigenous Peoples Day. I pride myself on expanding my worldview. You know, I might have a certain way of looking at things, but I want to see how other people see the world as well. So I thought about it, and he and I negotiated that instead of changing Columbus Day to Indigenous Peoples Day, we would share the holiday. We'd have Columbus Day / Indigenous Peoples Day on our calendar. Unfortunately, I don't know why that's not a good fix anymore. But in an effort to not exclude the Italian-American culture, I wonder if the board would be able to consider that or consider another day for the Indigenous people of Americas. So thank you.
Thank you so much.
Good evening. My name is Tony Corsetti. I live on 16067 Amore Street, Clinton Township. I was born and raised in Italy. I was educated in Italy. I've studied the history and times of Christopher Colombo since my elementary schools. I can assure you that the real story of Christopher Colombo has nothing to do with the garbage written by the gentleman, has published, popularized so many lies and misinformation. I found very absurd that an information when a decision so important can be made based on little knowledge of the real story of Christopher Colombo. So please, think about it. I voted again. Thank you.
Thank you.
You can go ahead.
I'll make a meal quick. Thank you. My name is Lisa Valerio Nauk. I live at 20761 Mervindale in Clinton Township. I have been a resident of Clinton Township for over 40 years. My parents were first, came from here, from Italy. I'm first generation Italian. I've worked with the Sorana Society. I have worked at San Francisco Catholic Church. I have been a member of the Italian American Cultural Center. And I'm also the incoming president of the Columbus Day Committee, which I am very proud to follow. I'm very proud to follow many of the men here and women who have been part of that committee, Mark Papali being one. And I will say this. When I found out that you guys were going to take away the one holiday that really meant a lot to my parents because it was a symbol of how Italians and Americans can be together. It really was like a kick in the gut. I have been part of the Italian-American community for my whole life. These people give and give and give. And now what we're getting back from you guys is we really don't care. So I'm asking you to care. I'm asking you to think about this. We have invited everyone to our Columbus Day celebration. It's not just for the Italians. We're almost like the Irish. When you say on St. Patrick's Day, everyone's Irish. Columbus Day, everybody's Italian. We invite you to join us. We invite you to learn more about our culture. And we're inviting you to bring back Columbus Day where it belongs. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Michael Garvanek. I'm part of the Italian-American Cultural Society. And I actually didn't believe this happened when I heard about this Columbus Day being removed. And they had to play the video of when it happened. So, you know, the lady that just spoke before me, she mentioned, she says, I'd love to have each of you at one of the Columbus Day functions we have, whether it be Fern Hill, whether it be a Italian American Cultural Center, to celebrate this great holiday with us, because it's really a sharing of Italians and Americans, how good we get along, the history and everything going on with that. And I look at this, and I went to so many halls and businesses in the last week, called people, let everybody know. Most people say, I don't believe you about what's going on. I says, I want you to dial in tonight, see what's going on. But what I do believe, knowing many of you here that sits on this board here, you're caring people. You have families. And I'll tell you, the Italian community, whether you've had tile, ceramic tile done in your house, it was probably an Italian. Whether you had your driveway poured, it's probably Italian. If you went to the fruit market, it was probably Italian. The Italian culture touches us in every way we know. When you go this next week, you will do business and talk to people, and high probability, you'll be speaking to an Italian. And you'll get along great with them because they give back, they're caring. They mentioned a few of the fruit markets here. I have been involved in multiple charities. And when I went to Nino Savaggio's or went to Luciano's for a gift certificate or went to Vincent Joe's to get gift baskets to give to the different charities around this great city, we'll talk to you later, we'll do it. So what I ask each of you of a couple of things is this. I would love to have you be part of the next function. Be part of it. Be part of the great Italian community we have here. Because I want everyone, we've been talking to the newspapers, everyone says, these people care. And I'm asking you to share the Italian culture, to share it with us. Be part of it. We'll get another day for Indigenous Peoples Day, because that should be celebrated. But I'm asking you to reconsider. God bless each and one of you, and please, reconsider.
Thank you, Mike. I know that to be true about our houses. The Italians built Clinton Township. I mean, that's just the way it is. And they still continue to build Clinton Township through and through. I think all of you know how I feel. I have, next is Pam White.
I have the privilege to run the Italian Tribune newspaper, which is 113 years old, and I know a few of you up here. One thing that you have to realize about Columbus and Columbus Day and the Italians is this. In the 1900s, when the Italian Americans came over here from Italy, and we all come from different countries, every single one of you, I don't see one Native American really on your board up here. So we all come from different countries up here, we're all immigrants here. And when they immigrated here, the one thing that they held true to in the early 1900s is that Christopher Columbus had the courage and the bravery to come to a new world and make a new home. Did he ever step foot on North America? No. However, it's ironic how revered he is in, you know, the southern, in the Caribbean where he was. And yet up here in the north, he is bastardized. And I find that very ironic. Now, the thing is about the Italian-Americans at Christopher Columbus is that even when they were making 2 cents per hour and they were thought of also in a very bad light, they would give 1 cent so that they could build a statue for Columbus. And the reason why is because they are very proud people. So when you look at Columbus Day and you say, well, Columbus Day, we should just get rid of it because they don't, you know, it's oppressive, you think. It's not about Columbus. It's about the Italian Americans who had the fortitude to come over here from another country and build a life and give so much of themselves and their country to this new world. So it's not just about a holiday that a state, that a president decided to make. It's about the Italian Americans who stand behind that holiday. So remember that when you are making your decisions, because you could be next, for one. And for two, in about 10 more years, it might not even matter. So because, you know, you don't know what holidays are going to be taken away. So when it comes to you, if you're going to start taking other people's holidays away, what holiday of yours means something to you that you don't want taken away?
Dr. Colbert.
Grace and peace, everyone. I'm Dr. Rodney Tolbert, 43608 Court, Clinton Township, Michigan. I'm the pastor of Liberty Missionary Baptist Church in Pontiac, Michigan. I sit on the board with Mr. Rocker. I sit on the Economic Development Commission here. I go to all of your Italian stores. Love Nino Sabaggio. I am not happy because when you try to separate, you divide. Mm-hmm. We as African Americans fought long and hard just to get a holiday. We celebrated Columbus Day just like everybody else. Why would we decide to take something away to replace it with something else? It's enough of this dividing one another based off of race, religion, or national origin. Yep. As a pastor, my responsibility is to tell the truth. And here's the truth. God don't care about your color. He cares about your soul. I say to you all, please reconsider. Don't make any changes. The state hasn't made a change. The county hasn't made a change. And if you really want to study history, only 4 states in the District of Columbia made any changes. I say, please, please, please reconsider. Thank you very much.
I will not sit down. I agree with him. Is Dominic Mashari still here?
Mr. Cannon, I just wanted to announce that Claudia McCracken is on remotely and is agreeing. 7:45, it said yes with an exclamation point, 7:52.
Yes.
Okay. Dominic J. Mosheri, I take this very personal. My father celebrated his last birthday on Columbus Day, together on his 60th anniversary with my mother. Our whole family went to the state capitol to receive the Columbus Day Award for the entire family. As Mr. Cannon mentioned earlier, regarding households in Clinton Township, probably 65 to 70% of the households constructed in Clinton Township, of which we reside in, were built by my direct relatives, by my father, Dominic Mosheri, my grandfather, Miguel Grillo, and Jerry Grillo, my uncle Mike Churko, my uncle Cosmo Lombardo, and cousin Anthony Lombardo, all first cousins and uncles of all the same family. They came over all the same time. We're all first generation. Approximately 12,000 Clinton Township households, which would represent, in population terms, approximately 35,000 of your residents live in Mosheri or our extended relatives' homes. But aside from that was the pride of joy of my father celebrating with his family. But it says it's not about our family. It's about everybody. It's about everybody that's come to this country, not just Italians, everybody that's immigrated that found a new way and a new course. But if we're going to use this logic in regards to removing Columbus Day, our nation's capital, District of Columbia, let's get real. There's Columbus, Ohio. Maybe that one's not too bad to start with. So we'll start there. If we're going to remove a name, Columbus, let's do it in Ohio. But nonetheless, in tongue in cheek, it extends further and further. Where does it stop? Where does it stop? We have Washington State. We have Washington Township. Washington was a slave owner. You have $1 bill in your pocket, burn it. Where does this stop and start? The rationale is beyond me. Romeo, Michigan, Rome, they were savages. They were hedonists at one time. Let's get rid of the word Rome from our vocabulary. But we don't. What we have right now is a celebration of all peoples, including indigenous peoples. I've studied at the University of Michigan several courses in Native American policy. And if anything, collectively is the best answer, is not to remove one, but to add the other. We're an inclusive community, not exclusive. So if this consideration is to be brought together, let's bring it an inclusive. Let's have an indigenous people celebrated together with Columbus, because they did celebrate together. This Thanksgiving was all about that, coming together. Both the immigrants, whether it doesn't matter which country, together with the indigenous people. So I thank you for this time, and look forward to reconsideration. Thank you.
Thank you.
Can I say one more thing, sir?
No.
I can't?
No. Unfortunately.
That's okay. I have my time.
Joel Rutherford?
Good evening, Board. Supervisor Brown. My name is Joel Rutherford. I'm a resident, of Warren, Michigan. I'm also the chair of the Democratic Black Caucus from Macomb County. Sometimes I actually get to speak to elected officials because of good things that happen. I have to say congratulations to this board because you were able to make MLK Day at Juneteenth paid holidays for your employees. One thing that, you know, growing up, my dad said, you can tell what the priorities are from anyone or any group based on their budget. So, of course, it's going to cost money, but it's something that you did. When it comes to Columbus Day, one thing I will say is this. I've heard from people, and I look at it this way. Everyone should be proud of their heritage. I'm proud of my heritage as being a Black American. The one thing that I did was serve over 20 years in active duty Air Force and almost 20 years as far as Department of Defense. I've spent over 38 years of my life defending this country, 10 of it overseas. But the one thing that I do see is this. People should be proud of their heritage, but at the same time, they have to face the truth of things that have happened. Columbus Day is something that for so many feel that it's basically about colonization. It's about what happened where the slave trade started, and my relatives came over here in chains. I wonder how many other people here did that have talked so far about their heritage and about the Statue of Liberty. So what I say is this: have an Italian American Day, but allow indigenous people to have their day, because, you know, they are truly the people of this nation that have been more badly treated than Black Americans. So I thank you for what you've done, and I hope that you stand tall and stand courageous and continue the good work. Thank you.
Thank you, Joel. Sam Bichelle.
Change of topic, but also on something that was removed from the agenda tonight. And this is the Consumer Energy's industrial spoils pile that's in my front yard and is next to the townhomes and a park. This, as you all know, other than Julie, you just got here. I know you didn't get it. I'm going to point you out. Consumers Energy actually said they did not test this soil. They refused to test the soil. They didn't do it, and they let this board know. And so tonight's agenda item, when it came on, when I saw it this morning, because like I said, I checked at 10:30 last night, it was the fact that the Consumer Energy Berm's completion was going to be celebrated. It's never been before the Planning Commission. This board would not even let me, when Consumers Energy was here, you wouldn't even let me ask a question of them on this. We have, there again, the township attorney has taken pictures of everything that was added to this project, 2 years of construction, and we've got a 22-acre site in Clinton Township that has never had a site plan, did not get a site plan now. There again, with all of these additions, and there was lots of them, there is no change in the tax law because the assessor didn't get any of anything feedback for a site plan. We have to wonder what committee was dealing with this completion. There again, you all know I put a FOIA in today to see all the agenda and minutes to the meetings where this was discussed. I'd like to know who did that, and I'm sure my FOIA, when it comes out, will come back. But I know the attorney, like I said, he took pictures from my front yard because, you know, you guys kind of considered that I didn't know what I was talking about, that all this stuff was right in my front yard. It is. You can see this berm from my front yard. I think that, there again, if you want to respect people, you have to get that soil tested. You have to explain to us how it can be that this big company can be in Clinton Township, have all these new items put in, including a service station, open 24 hours a day, and no site plan. It's just not explainable. And there again, my daughter-in-law loves charging her electric car there when she's at my house, because you can see it. There's not a bush or a tree in between us. And there again, the attorney's pictures can easily point out to y'all. And there again, this berm completion, you might want to go out and see what's growing there right now, because as I said, it's been there for over 3 years and nothing was growing. And this year, consumers, when they were here, they said they were going to put all this, you know, work into making something grow there. Well before fall, everything that was put there died. And if you come out, you can see all the nice green grass. Okay, all the nice green grass every place else, this stuff is dead. What are you doing to us? What are you doing to the kids? Thank you.
Joe Hayes.
Thank you for hearing us today. My name is Joseph Hayes. I live at 42309 Jason Drive in Clinton Township. I've been a resident here for 22 years. I'm Scotch-Irish. I don't have a dog in this cultural fight. But I have to tell you, I do have a big problem with the successful evisceration of an American holiday. This is an attack on our American history. Our American history is a big part of Columbus Day. Columbus discovered the North American continent, even though he landed in some islands. The slavers were the Portuguese and the Spaniards on the Spanish Main. That's where the indigenous cultures really got their butts kicked. So, that being said, I ask that you please, please reconsider this nasty thing that you have done to the Italian people, a smack in your face, the people that have built Clinton Township, what it is today and how beautiful it is today and how wonderful and inclusive and loving these people can be. This is an absolute wrong thing to do, and I'm asking the people in the audience and on the other side of that camera, if this is not rescinded, please remember this on the next election cycle.
This isn't exactly as all of you would have liked. However, I think your views were all presented. It would have been different had you had the item on the agenda that was there before someone removed it, which is what I wanted. I wanted to have an opportunity to vote on that item tonight. I said 2 weeks ago that this room would be filled if people knew what was on that agenda.
It would have been a lot more than this.
I know that. No, you guys cannot speak from the audience. I'm sorry, Mike. I appreciate you coming out. Please keep track of this board. Hopefully, this isn't the last this board will address the issue. Thank you. A motion is in order to adjourn.
I'll make a motion to adjourn.
Is there a second?
Support.
Roll call, please.
Welcome.
It's nice having you here.
Trustee Patton. Trustee Patton. Trustee West. Trustee Matuzak. Trustee Keyes.
Yes.
Supervisor Cannon.
Right, so
Treasurer Gillingham. Clerk Meltzer, yes. Motion passes.
Thank you.
I don't, I think